Today. How's everybody doing?
Wonderful.
Great. You all look great.
So do you.
I mean, considering what you had to work with, you look fine. You look good today. Before we go any further to officially install Pastor Steve and Candi, we have to remember Jesus is the one who was, is, and is to come. So we have to look back for a second. Then we'll stay in the moment, then we'll talk about the future. The first thing we need to do before we go one step further is to show our love and appreciation and gratitude, deep gratitude for David and Pam and their leadership. Amen. Has it really been 5 years? My goodness gracious. I have found you to be the most encouraging group I've ever been with, most open, the best eaters I've ever seen. You have the ministry of eating. It's like nobody's own. I found it to be a joy to be with you on Sunday mornings. I left here always wishing I could stay longer because you are worthy of investment. You are movers and shakers in the kingdom of God. You've grown a great deal in 5 years. God has confirmed you. Confirmation as a group, as a family. He's bonded you together. He's provided for you acreage, opportunity. I mean, a clean slate. You have done what many startups have never done. The 5 years is unheard of. And you've done that really without a full-time pastor, although we've leaned on David for that. So I commend you. I'm blown away by where we are, and I'm so excited for the chapter that lies ahead. For weeks now, I have been preaching and trying to build a case that the fullness of Christ, the maturity in Christ, the unity in Christ, the discernment that comes to a believer in Christ, really comes from the fivefold ministry being expressed or influenced in a church's life. And this church is starting to show the signs of those five areas of emphasis. You're apostolic. You're a church plant, right? You're prophetic. You have a, this is going to be this place right here over on the hill, and this one here is going to be a voice of one calling in the world that's put, telling forth and foretelling the word of God to Scaly, Otto, Raven County, Clayton, Sky Valley. It's going to continue and only intensify. I hope you're ready for that. I hope you're ready to pray apostolically. I hope you're ready to pray the strongholds off of this area. I hope you're ready to take it to a whole new level, because we're both apostolic as a ministry, both prophetic and evangelistic. Now, this is going to be key. We have to strategically evangelize people. Cannot ignore the younger generation. A mantle that has to fall on you fresh and anew to share the gospel with the people of this community. They have to see you as having something they've longed for their entire life and have yet to really internalize. And above that, you need a pastor and a teacher. Well, the Lord has provided you a more than capable pastor. The great shepherd has provided a good shepherd. And you have now what it takes, the good teaching, the word, everything is in place. But there's work to do. There's not time to coast. It's time now to pick up a plow. Plow the harvest fields with prayer. Plant the seeds of the gospel. Encourage one another. Reach out. And we're going to have to, I hate to say the word sacrifice, because I'm not sure we really know what sacrifice means in this country. But we're going to have to really focus to do what needs to be done on this mountain, these mountains. Okay, great opportunity. So I end with saying that, you know, it's been a joy for me. I got to travel with some of you all. We went to Israel, seen you just grow, seen some of you come to Christ. Blown away by that. Thank you for the opportunity to do that. So that's where we've been, and that's kind of where we are. But let's talk about who's going to get us there. So let's have, if you would, Pastor Steve and Candi come up, and the elders, you know, with the laying on of hands, we're going to pray for their leadership, their ministry. Okay, this is not a spectator sport. We need to all be praying here. Majestic is your name in all the earth. The heavens declare your glory. On this man as a shepherd, I pray a fresh, new, exciting, infectious, invigorating mantle of pastoral leadership, teaching, preaching, nurturing, compassion. Bless this man when he comes in and when he goes out. Bless him in the city and in the country. Let favor and a good name rest upon this man. Give him eyes to see and ears to perceive specifically what your Spirit is saying to him for this time, this season, this transition, this community, this church, these people, your word, the person, the Trinity, the Godhead, everything. Reveal what needs to be revealed that this man may walk worthy of the calling you placed upon him at this time in this place. Anoint his lips. Let him gain respect, credibility as a workman approved, who rightly divides the word of truth. Let no weapon come against him prosper. Help him overcome by the power of the blood of the Lamb, the word of our testimony in the name of Jesus Christ. Insulate this congregation from oppression, division, doubt, despair, and infuse them, Lord, by your Spirit, with hope, promise, servitude, duty, that we may see good, great, and mighty things, unsearchable things that we do not know. Provide for this man. Don't muzzle the ox that treads the grain. Provide for this man. Provide financially for this church. And raise up a building, a temple, not just a sanctuary, but a place where people will take sanctuary. Not just a temple, but a place where you dwell. Do in us what we cannot do for ourselves. And use this man for your glory and honor. Use the elders. Use this priesthood that you've placed here for your glory. And upon this woman, I pray favor, insight, discernment, wisdom, a sensitivity to your voice, your word. I pray encouragement, the gift of encouragement. I fan in the flames the gifts that are in by the laying out of hands. And I ask you, Father, to use her for your glory. To foretell and tell forth the word of God. To teach, to instruct. To show women how, Lord, to love their husbands. To minister at a point of need. Do for her what she cannot do for herself. Let nothing come against her household. Fill her house with laughter. Her children, her grandchildren, with joy unspeakable and full of glory. Help her, Lord, to feed the poor, to lead women, a charge of women, to pray, to harvest souls, to give birth to revival. We ask these things through this couple for your glory and for your honor, expecting, Father, that you hear and answer prayer. Well, thank you for it. We'll enjoy you in it. And we ask you to do through us things that we don't even think about yet, things we have yet to even ask you yet. We thank you for that in advance in Jesus' name. We now declare this man the pastor of this church, in accordance with your word and your confirmation in the body of Christ. And we bring the respect that is due the position. Build him up in the most holy faith. I pray for a continued transparency, wise counsel, insight, openness, love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, and self-control. Keep your hand upon these special people and use them for your glory. And everyone said, amen. Amen. All right, let's give the Lord praise.
Continue our service. We're going to just praise the Lord with a singing of Mighty Fortress. God has started the fire on this mountain, and he is a consuming fire. We pray that he will consume us with his love.
Keep our eyes on you. Fortress is our God. Well, I sure appreciate Gary's kind words and his prayer. Is this on?
Yeah.
Did you turn me on?
No.
Oh, I didn't mean that. The way it sounded was a little awkward. We're gonna pray first, and then we'll have our tithes and offerings. Do you have something on your heart that you'd like for us to lift up together? I know you do. We have some people that have concerns, and I have a concern for my friend right there. She, Doc Champion, she, you know, when somebody shares with you there's something going on in their life, you go, oh, I'm sorry. Or you can pray and trust the Lord for that issue. And I want to pray for you, Doc. I pray for everyone else and pray for you. And if you have a concern on your heart, something about yourself, you know, Lord, I'd like to grow deeper in my walk with you. It's pretty shallow right now. Maybe just make that a prayer to God. Maybe the Lord is leading you to do something and you just don't have the courage yet to do it. Say, God, I need the courage to do that thing. Maybe there's a relationship that needs to be mended and you just feel guilty about it. Today, you're going to decide with God's strength to make that call or make that visit. Be reconciled to another. And so whatever's on your heart, let's bring it before the Lord, okay? Our Father, we are so grateful that we can come into your very presence, and you've given us all these illustrations of your welcoming us into your presence. We see in Revelation that there is a door, but it's never closed. And that means we can come into your presence at any time and for any reason, at any hour, and you hear our prayers, and we are so thankful. Just like that little tune, great is thy faithfulness, you are so faithful. You love us so much. You love us more than we can ever imagine. And Lord, you're concerned about us. You're concerned about my friend, Doc Champion, and the ailment that is plaguing her body. And she just feels the aches and pains of rheumatoid arthritis and the other malady that she's dealing with. And so, Lord, we pray for the Spirit of the living God to do what only you can do in her life. Doctors have said, here, try this medicine. We're asking you to minister to her in a supernatural way and enter into her body and bring relief to her pain. And these other concerns that we have, we lift them before you because we can. The Bible says you delight in the prayers of your people. The Bible says that our prayers are like sweet incense that rise into the very presence of Holy God. Your Bible says to us, commit your cares, cast all your cares upon me because I care about you. You're the burden bearer. You've already borne our sins on the cross. Now you want to bear with us those things that plague our life. And so we commit ourselves to you. We pray for courage. We pray for the Spirit of the living God to fall fresh on us this day. As I was prayed for a new anointing, I pray for a fresh anointing on every person here. Fill us with your Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen. Let us continue to worship the Lord with his tithes and our offerings.
To give us a beautiful offering to the Lord, to give me Jesus. We just want to give God thanks for healing Bob. Bob has been through a lot the past few months, and this is a miracle to have him back today in the lesson.
In the morning when I rise,
In the morning when I rise, give me Jesus. Give me Jesus. Give me Jesus. You can have all this world, but give me Jesus. And when I come to die, oh, and when I come to die, when I come to die, give me Jesus.
Thank you, Bob. That was... Don't you love that song? Man, give me Jesus. That's enough for me. I want to share some verses of Scripture. And, why does it do this? You have no idea, do you? Why not? That's why we pay you the big bucks. It's my electric personality. Yeah. But I want to share some scripture with you. And okay. I love the Bible. And, you know, Wesley referred to himself as a Bible bigot. And I understand what he means by that. I love the Bible. And so we're going to look at verses of Scripture. Not a whole lot. I'm not going to take a lot of your time because We're going to have a little reception afterwards and hope everyone will stay for that. We'd like to get to know you a little better. The Bible is so important, and there's a fivefold purpose in the Bible. And the first is this, is that the Bible is a book of history. What we have in the Gospels is the history of what happens when the Messiah comes and what takes place. And then we have a book of theology. The second thing about the Bible is it's filled with history. It's not just a history book, it's a theology book. And we start in the book of Acts, and then we have the epistles, where we have Paul and Peter and other writers writing theology, what we believe and why we believe it, and it's our faith and what our faith is based on. That's what theology is, a study of God, and we find it in the book of Acts and in the epistles. And of course, the third thing is we have a book it's about the last days. What's going to happen? We want to be informed. Paul says God does not want us to be ignorant. And so we have this book called Revelation. It's about eschatology, the last times of what's going to take place so that we're not caught off guard. And then the Bible, there's another part to the Bible, and that is it's a book about prophecy. It's prophetic, and that's the Old Testament. And the Old Testament basically is a book about the prophecies relating to the coming of the Messiah. What's going to happen when it happens. And that's in the Old Testament. And then we have the Word that becomes flesh in us. It's not just a book of history, it's not just a book of theology, it's not just a book of prophecy, it's not just a book that we look at and we say, wow, this is... No, it's a book that transforms our lives. That's the purpose of it, to inform us in order to change us. And so over the period of time that we're here, we're going to be looking at the Word of God, because that's our power. And that's what makes a difference. It's not my opinion, but it's the Word of God that matters. So today I just want to read some scriptures, a few scriptures, make some comments, have a benediction, or have communion and then a benediction, and then we'll eat some. I like that. We should do it every week. Acts 20:28. This is a word for us, for me and Ken. It says, pay careful attention to yourselves. Steve, pay careful attention to yourself. Candi, pay careful attention to yourself. That is, how you're living, what you're saying, what you're teaching, your influence. Pay careful attention to yourself. Be real careful that you encourage and you don't offend. So that's what this scripture says. Pay careful attention to yourselves and to all of the flock. Oh my goodness. To everybody, to you, to every person that's a part of this church. Pay careful attention to all the flock. So we want to get to know you better. And we want to, over a period of time, we're going to call you and ask you to come to our house and bring something. Chocolate chip cookies, oatmeal raisin cookies, and particularly cherry pie. Yeah. And I'm just joking there. Don't bring much. But we want to get to know you better. We want you to come to our house. We just want to talk. Okay? Let you get to know us. We want to get to know you better. And so he goes on to say, pay careful attention to yourself and to all the flock in which, now listen, the Holy Spirit has made you overseers. See, that's real important. The Holy Spirit is behind this. This is not your doing. This is God's doing. We're here because the Holy Spirit has brought us here to care for, that's our calling, for the church of God, which he obtained with his blood. So this church is precious. Okay, Hebrews 10:24-25. Thinking about that, listen to what the writer of the Hebrews says. And let us, that's you and me, consider how to stir up. Now, it doesn't mean stir up trouble, right? Let us consider how to stir up one another. The word stir up may basically in this context means stimulate one another, stimulate action, a Christ-honoring direction in someone's life. Stimulate that person to honor Christ in some way, to encourage, let us do that. You need to figure out, how can I stir up this pastor? How can I stir up you to do something? But what? He tells us to love and good works. Acts 2:47, one of my favorite scripture, describes the early church and what was taking place when the Spirit of God comes and there's a movement that's created. Acts 2:47 says, they were praising God, remember, and having favor with all people. In the early years, they were having favor with all people. And, you know, favor happens when people see in us something appealing. When other people, lost people, see in us, or perhaps unchurched people, your neighbors, when they see in you something that is appealing, you then gain favor. That is, they like you. They like us. That's what was happening. People were liking the Christians. And the Lord was added to their numbers. Those people who had favor said, you know, I like what I see. And the Lord started adding to their numbers. Look at this. Day by day, day in and day out, those who were being saved. What if this happens here? What if so much favor happens in Sky Valley and wherever you live that our church every single day adds to our numbers because of how we're living? And adding to our numbers day by day, how about 365 days a year, people who are being saved because of us join us. Wouldn't that be something? I don't think that's out of the realm of possibilities. 1 Peter 2:9. You know this verse. It says, but you are a chosen race. Israel was a chosen people. Christians are a chosen people. We are chosen by God. We are a chosen race of people in this world. Set apart, unique from the world. We are a chosen race in the world, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for God's own possession. God possesses us. We're part of the family of God, that we may proclaim his excellencies of him who called us out of darkness and into his marvelous light. This is who we are. This is who you are. The people of God. I don't know if you've ever thought of this, but do you ever feel disconnected? You know, you feel like, oh, here's Christ, here are people that are working, and here, and I just feel so disconnected. That's not true. If you could see yourself, you would see yourself as part of the whole. You are in Christ. You are in him. And as in him, you are his people, a chosen people of God to proclaim who he is in the world. All right, 1 Corinthians 3:9 says, for we are God's fellow workers. Not just me, but all of us, Candy and all of us, we are God's fellow workers. He calls us to this task. You are, Paul says, you are God's field, meaning he will plant you somewhere. He planted us here. He's planted you in his providence where you are right now. You are God's field, God's building. 1 Thessalonians 5:11 says, therefore, encourage one another and build one another up, just as you are doing. Keep it up. And let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, to which you indeed were called into one body, and be thankful. Let's pray. Father, I for one am very thankful. I am overwhelmed by your providence that you, in your perfect plan, planted us here for this season of our lives and in the life of this church. It reminds me of Psalm 1 that talks about being like a tree planted by the rivers of living water that brings forth its fruits in its season. And Father, we're just praying for that. We're praying for a great harvest in this community. We're praying that our tree will feed a lot of people, and that our fruit, the fruit of the Spirit, will become so obvious to people they will have favor on us and desire what we have. They will be jealous for what we have. And so we ask you, Lord, to use this congregation this day and forevermore. In Jesus' name, amen. Going to have a Holy Communion together, and you're invited to come. Before you partake, you know, the Bible says that we're to approach the Lord with a clean heart, clean hands. We're going to take a moment right now. We're going to bow our heads, and if there's something between you and God, there's some wall between you and God, some sin between you and God, or sins between you and God, just confess your sin to Him. Do it privately. It's between you and God. And ask Him to forgive you, and He will. So would you bow your heads and let's pray together for just a moment. Examine our hearts, O God. Jesus, you are our Redeemer. You redeem us from our mistakes. You redeem us from our sins. You forgive us. You remove our sins as far as the east is from the west, but we must take responsibility for them. We must confess our sins, knowing that you are faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and then to cleanse us of all of our unrighteousness. And so we take these sins of ours and we place them at the foot of the cross, knowing that that's where you died. You died for all those sins. And right now, we remember the night that Jesus, you instituted this new covenant, a new covenant that Jeremiah 2 speaks of and Ezekiel 36 speaks of, that you're going to establish a new covenant with us, and you're going to give us a new heart, and you're going to put the Spirit of God within us. And that new covenant came as a result of blood. And we remember this day the new covenant and what it cost to acquire that covenant. And so we remember Jesus' death and we remember His resurrection, that you took all that you had and laid it aside, becoming a servant for us, so that we, the undeserved, could enter into a relationship with Holy God. In Jesus' name, amen. We have the individual communion. If you would like to have that, to just raise your hand, or you can come up through and receive it through the tension.
John 17, Jesus prayed that his church, his body, would be one heart so that the world would know that God sent him. Let's stand as we sing our closing hymn, What a Mighty God We Serve.
Shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and fill you with his peace. Amen.
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 Amen. Please join us for reception.